So have you ever seen somebody sleep with their eyes open? Yes, this may look a little creepy, but it's actually pretty common. In fact, I bet if you've ever woken up with your eyes feeling a little bit dry and irritated in the morning, there's a good chance you may have a mild to moderate case of what is called noctornal lagophthalmos, where your eyes remain a little bit open at nighttime, leaving your eyes to dry out, causing severe dry eye symptoms. So today we're going to review some of the causes of lagophthalmos and then share some helpful tips that'll help you with dry eye symptoms from sleeping with your eyes open. Let's take a look. This episode of the Dr. Eye Health Show is dedicated to a very special viewer, Paula, who not only sent me a beautiful letter, but sent me this amazing piece of artwork. Thank you, Paula. I can't tell you how much I appreciate you. Again, this one is for you. So again, today we're talking all about lagophthalmos. In this condition, you lose the ability to close your eyelid, and this can occur due to any malfunction of the muscle or the nerves that control the orbicularis oculi, the muscle that controls the closing of the eyelid. This often occurs due to a problem with cranial nerve 7, the facial nerve. And in school, you actually are taught that cranial nerve 3, as with three fingers, that opens the eye, and cranial nerve 7, kind of making a little hook with your finger, that closes the eye. But loss of function of this nerve not only prevents you from closing your eyelid, but it reduces your blink reflex and even stops the pumping mechanism of the lacrimal gland in creating more tears. For most people, this means that your eyelids are not closing correctly throughout the day and at night, which leaves your eyes open and exposed to the environment, which causes your tear film to evaporate, leaving your eyes becoming severely dry. In addition, the seventh cranial nerve also activates again that lacrimal gland and the pumping mechanisms of getting tears to your eyes. And so not only are your tears evaporating, but you're not producing enough tears to lubricate that eye as well. And this often results in severe forms of dry eye that almost just seem never to get better. And in the eye clinic, we can even see this on the eye as a very distinct dry spot on the lower part of the cornea. And we often refer to this as exposure keratopathy. So now that we know what the problem is, let's cover just a few of the things that can cause lagophthalmos, because there's some medical conditions you want to be aware of, but then we'll cover some of the different dry eye treatments that your eye doctor may recommend. There are several different medical causes for lagophthalmos. It could be benign or idiopathic. In fact, for young kids that come in with dry eye symptoms, it's one of the first things I look for, and I even ask parents if they've ever seen their kids sleep with their eyes a bit open, and you'd be surprised at how often I actually see that. But one medical condition I did want to mention first is that of Bell's palsy, which is pretty frequent. It's where your facial muscles on one side of the face end up drooping, and then you can't really close your eyelids correctly, and so again, they dry out. It's still a bit of a medical mystery. They don't entirely know what causes Bell's palsy, but it's believed to be caused by an acute viral infection or herpes simplex virus. Thankfully for a lot of people, Bell's palsy does improve over time, but again, work with your doctors. Hopefully they can help you out. Other causes of lagophthalmos could be from trauma to the face, surgery, tumors, cerebral vascular accidents, or stroke. And then there's two other medical conditions that eye doctors like myself really have to pay attention to. That one is thyroid eye disease and sleep apnea. Thyroid eye disease is a pretty complex condition, and I do plan to review that in more detail in a future video. But in short, it's where the muscles around the eye end up swelling, and then it, because there's not enough room in the orbit, it pushes the eyes out of the eye socket and becomes proptotic. And then the eyelids, because the eye's in the way, can't fully close all the way. And then sleep apnea is important for eye doctors to pay attention to for two reasons. One, because a lot of people with sleep apnea have a CPAP machine to help them sleep, and airflow from those CPAP machines can end up squirting into their eye, causing severe dryness. And then sleep apnea is also strongly associated with what is called floppy eyelid syndrome. That's where you don't have enough elastin protein in your tissues, and the eyelids become a bit floppy, and they lose their rigidity. And either the top eyelid can overlap the bottom eyelid, causing irritation, or what happens is the top eyelid ends up flipping inside out on itself, and while you're sleeping at night and you move your head along your pillow, either the inside of the upper eyelid rubs against the pillowcase, or even the eyeball itself can rub and just be exposed to the environment, again leading to severe dryness. Now again, this is not a complete list of everything that can cause lagophthalmos, but they're probably the most common that I see. And if any of these conditions kind of spark some curiosity for you of what might be going on for you, then I encourage you to talk with your local eye doctor so they can test things and figure out what's going on. So now, how does your eye doctor treat somebody with exposure keratitis from something like lagophthalmos or sleeping with their eyes open? The first thing your doctor is usually going to recommend is using lubricating artificial tears at least about 4 times throughout the day. Now, typically, lubricating drops that are a little bit thicker and contain what is called methyl cellulose is recommended. I personally like to start off with something like Refresh Reliva. That's great for just about most people, but you could also look for something called Celluvisc, which is a bit thicker. But keep in mind, the thicker the drops, yes, they'll last longer on the eyes, but they may also obscure and blur your vision. And again, a pro tip is always try to look for preservative-free if you can when it comes to these eye drops. Because again, you're using these drops frequently throughout the day, and you don't want to be getting like kind of a preservative burn on the surface of your eye from all those different chemicals. I like the analogy that if somebody was to shampoo their hair like 4 or 5 times a day, you can imagine that shampoo is eventually gonna like scorch their scalp. So it's basically the same thing with using preserved eye drops. We're worried that you're gonna have a toxic reaction. And in fact, we do see that in the clinic with some people. So again, preservative-free. And if you have a more severe case, your doctor's probably gonna recommend something like a gel or ointment, which is much thicker and is definitely probably gonna obscure your vision. And ointments, in my experience, are a little bit more difficult to put in, and I do have a tutorial video of how to put those in correctly, so if you wanna learn a little bit more about that, again, you can check out that video. And just to make it easier to find that video, you can click the YouTube card up above, or again, I'll put links to everything in the video description below so you can find it easily. Another possible option is that of using a nighttime sleep mask, moisture seals, or shields that you can wear at nighttime, even moisture goggles throughout the day, or again while you're sleeping. These are all different ways to keep the eyelids closed or protect the eyes or prevent the tears from evaporating directly into the air. And again, you're kind of creating this nice safe environment for your eyes, either while you sleep or throughout the day. Some of these different products around eye shields and moisture goggles are a little difficult to find at times, so I have done a few reviews of them, and if you want to check out those videos, again, I'll put those in the description below. Now, some more advanced options that your doctor may recommend, and these are usually left kind of at the end stage of the disease, where people's eyes are having decompensation and risk of scarring or ulceration. This could be such as using a gold weight implant, that's where a gold weight is implanted in your upper eyelid, and the gold, which is inert, basically sits there and helps keep the eyelid more closed, making it easier for you to close your eyelids throughout the day and at night. I've only seen gold weight implants in one person in my career, and from what I've heard, a lot of surgeons don't like to do it. It's not always successful. It's also cosmetically not really appealing because you can see that somebody's got something like embedded in their eyelid. And then in the case of kind of the last resort that we have is a surgical procedure called a Tarsorrhaphy, and that's where your surgeon will basically sew part of the eyelid shut, mostly on one side, and just leaves a little crack of the eyelid to be open so you can still visually function and see. But again, this is important for keeping the moisture on the surface of the eye and preventing any sort of ulceration or further damage to the eye itself. Again, it's not a pretty procedure, but for the people that need it, at least we have something. So eye question of the day, tell me which part of this video did you find most interesting and helpful, and if you yourself are struggling with dryness in the early morning, or if you sleep with your eyes open, anything like that, let us know what has helped for you the most. Again, I hope that in the comments section, people are able to connect, meet up, and maybe learn from each other and just create a really supportive environment for people who are either struggling with eye conditions or want to learn more about the eyes and the entire profession of optometry and ophthalmology. Otherwise, again, thank you so much for watching. I appreciate all of you who like, subscribe, and comment. Definitely hit that subscribe button down below if you are new and join our community. Otherwise, again, this is Dr. Alan here from Dr. Eye Health. Keep an eye on it, and we'll see you in the next one.